Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 21st meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item is for members of the committee to consider whether or not to take agenda item 3 in private. Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you very much. And our second agenda item is consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's Section 23 report into new vessels for the Clyde and Hebrides, arrangements to deliver vessels 801 and 802. And can I welcome our first witness this morning, David Middleton, who in 2015 was the Chief Executive of Transport Scotland. And David, before I invite you to make a short opening statement, the committee appreciates that time has lapsed since you left your role at Transport Scotland. However, you were the most senior official at Transport Scotland when key decisions to award that contract to Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited were made. So there are questions that we need to ask and questions that we need you to answer. But before we proceed to questions, can I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Yeah, well, it's just a short opening statement. Indeed, it's perhaps just a few remarks because it's not really about the substance. It's really just to follow what you just said there, convener. As I believe you're aware, I've had exchanges with your clerk about the basis of my appearance. But for the record, I should say that I've been retired from full-time public service for over 6 years. I left office as Chief Executive of Transport Scotland in early November 2015, just after contract award nearly 7 years ago. I'm not therefore in any position to offer opinions or answers based on any professional position which I currently occupy. I've had no access to support for this appearance. I've had the opportunity to review only those documents which were copied to me at the time I was Chief Executive. I've had no advice or steers from former colleagues beyond points of fact for responding to any questions. So my main basis for responding to any questions is recollection. However, I fully understand the public concern over these unfinished ferries, and if there are issues I can assist you with, I will do my best. I have seen the Audit Scotland report, and I have to a degree followed your proceedings, not least because my name has been mentioned from time to time. It does get your attention. However, I have not had the opportunity to have studied every document or every sentence of your consideration. But as I say, if I can help in any way, I will do my best.
Thank you, Mr. Middleton. We appreciate that. I'm going to turn first of all to the Deputy Convener of the Committee, Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions to put to you to begin with. Sharon.
Good morning, Mr. Middleton. The Auditor General for Scotland states that there's a mismatch between CMAL's strength of feeling about the scale of risk involved in awarding the contract to FMAIL and how this was communicated to ministers. As accountable officer for Transport Scotland at that time, what role did you have in providing advice to ministers?
I had no direct role. I mean, can I just clarify, when the Auditor General said mismatch, is that in his report or is that something he said separately?
Yeah, it's in the reports. It's in the report. From okay. The evidence right. We've taken.
CMAL had a view of risk. Concerns came to light. My director of the relevant part of Transport Scotland was working on these matters, and he and his officials worked through those issues and produced the submission, which I think people are aware of, which reported to ministers the risks that CMAL perceived. They reported the extent to which CMAL had negotiated some reduction in risk with Ferguson's, and they also reported the ways in which we felt we could offer reassurance and comfort to CMAL. And I was kept aware of those developments, and I saw the papers that were prepared in the relevant directorate in Transport Scotland, but I didn't personally participate in the discussions, and I didn't personally participate in any discussions with ministers.
So you didn't have any meetings with CMAL?
I had no meetings with CMAL, no.
And do you feel that the strength of feeling from CMAL about the preference for a builder's refund guarantee was fully conveyed to the ministers?
I think it was fully conveyed to the ministers, and I think the Audit Scotland report said in terms that our submission, I don't think anyone's doubted that the submission of 8th October, if I'm right, set out that position very clearly. It enclosed a number of documents as well as giving the Directorate's perspective on the issue.
Right. Well, from CMAL's submissions, they seemed very keen to go back to the procurement process because they would have preferred to proceed with a full builder's refund guarantee. Why were the ministers at that time so keen to proceed with the contract?
I think in terms of being keen, ministers understood that Ferguson's came out in top of the procurement in terms of cost and quality. And once the issues came to light on the builder's refund guarantee, there were extensive discussions between Transport Scotland and CMAL about how that could be dealt with. Indeed, I think in part of the covering advice that Transport Scotland put up to ministers at the time, we see ministers in plural, but to Derek Mackay, who I know you're speaking to later, it outlined the fact that some officials in CMAL had actually said that they might well have run into these problems in other respects. So what we discussed with CMAL and what CMAL helped in a way to prepare was the form of reassurance and the form of comfort about where risk would lie that gave them the confidence that they could accept the contract. I know that CMAL had their doubts about this, and I know that CMAL, but nonetheless, they participated in the process which drafted the letter of comfort, which gave them the opportunity to ultimately to enter into the contract.
Right. I know some of my colleagues here have got other questions than that. Can I just ask, when were you aware that there wasn't going to be a full builder's refund guarantee? When did you become aware of that?
I can't remember precisely. I mean, it emerged in that period between the announcement of the preferred bidder at the end of August through the course of September. I can't tell you what precise date in September I became aware of that.
So you weren't aware of it prior to the contract being awarded?
I think until the discussions after the contract award, I honestly cannot recollect, but in terms of reading of the documents, I would not be formally aware until sometime after that stage.
Okay. Well, can I just pick that point up? Because, my first question, was Transport Scotland present at the CMAL board during that period, August to October?
I think the record would show that John Nicholls and a colleague went along to the board meeting on the 25th of September. That's my understanding.
And the 25th of August as well.
Okay. I
think we have minutes from CMAL submitted to us which show that.
I accept that, yes. If that's what's in the minutes, that's what's in the minutes.
Yeah. And so based on what you've just said, I'm a bit confused because the papers for the CMAL board meeting on the 25th of August referred to the problem with the builder's refund guarantee. It's item 13 on the agenda of that meeting at which Transport Scotland officials were present. So surely you would be aware, as the accountable officer, of that major stumbling block.
I think the question I was asked was when precisely I was aware, and best of my recollection, I cannot go back and say precisely when I was aware. If the CMAL board papers say that and Transport Scotland officials were aware of that at that time, not everything is instantly reported to everybody in Transport Scotland, but certainly in the course of that period, I became aware of the builder refund guarantee and the extent to which my officials in that directorate were trying to deal with that issue. But if you're asking me a question of when, at what precise date and why didn't I know it was in the CMAL board papers, I can't give you a satisfactory answer to that, but I became aware as that period unfolded.
But in and around that period as well was quite a crucial date because 5 days before that CMAL board meeting where the builder's refund guarantee was a major issue, the 20th of August, Keith Brown, as the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, was told by a Transport Scotland official to approve the preferred bidder award to Ferguson Marine. So if there was knowledge of there being an issue around the builder's refund guarantee, certainly by the 25th of August, surely it was known on the 20th of August, and if so, why was that not communicated to the Cabinet Secretary?
I can't honestly answer that. It's probably the simplest answer rather than dissemble. If the 20th August submission was about advising ministers on the outcome of the procurement and who had come top on price and quality. And thereafter, the Builders Refund Guarantee became an issue as this process developed after the identification of the preferred bidder. Now, did someone in Transport... I mean, I can't go back in time to the 20th of August and know... You say if it was known by the board of the 25th of August, so why was it not known by the 20th of August? I can't... I mean, I'm sorry. This is the problem, just operating on your own and going back and looking at papers, as I can't give you an answer to that.
OK, but you would expect, would you not, in that period... for that to be quite well known, that CMAL had identified there being this major problem with the contract as it was being outlined by Ferguson Marine?
I mean, it's not unusual in procurements for issues to develop. I appreciate, because of the fact that the ferries remain unfinished, that things like the Builders Refund Guarantee, which essentially is a financial transaction, I mean, there was still widespread confidence that the yards could build the ships, but it is not uncommon in procurements for there to be issues which are then discussed even after the identification of the preferred bidder. I mean, negotiations and discussions go on. It doesn't mean it would have been a showstopper at that time.
OK. We're limited in time, so I want to move on to another issue, which is the issue of written authority. Hmm. And in your written submission to the committee... you said that on the issue of written authority, you say that you did not then nor now see this as any kind of decision. Could you explain to us what you mean by that?
Well, I think you asked me a question, you know, how did I decide whether... I mean, you don't decide whether to seek a written authority. I mean, if you think you're at all in the territory of requiring a written authority, which is an extremely rare event... I wouldn't like to quote how many there have been in post-devolution Scotland, but I gather it's really tiny, tiny numbers. It has been more prevalent in Whitehall for other reasons, and I think there's been a subject of journalistic comment, but that's another matter. So it would never have... I mean, I didn't have to sit and stroke my chin and say, oh, gosh, should I seek a written authority? I didn't have to seek a written authority about anything because I wasn't in a position to think... that we were going into something that had that I regarded as unwise. If I actually thought it was unwise and difficult and problematic, then there's a whole matter of consideration. And ultimately, the first port of call would have been a serious discussion with ministers. So the whole point was to try and find a way forward on this. And that's why we ended up in the submission in October, which advised ministers of the risks, which CMAL asked us to do, and advised of the mitigations in terms of the risk which both CMAL had negotiated with Ferguson's and the further way in which we transferred some of the financial risk as CMAL asked so that they would be harmless, I think the word they used in their submission. So I didn't have reasons to seek a written authority. In a sense, the main thing was that the matter was written up and put up to ministers so that they were fully aware of all the facts and fully aware of the positions. And that's why the documents from CMAL, both the longer one that came in early October and the previous documents, were put up to ministers in terms. And in that sense, that was making sure ministers had in writing before them all the issues. But the notion that an accountable officer, as I was, would ask for a written authority, which I have to say in all my upbringing was usually referred to as an instruction or a direction. The idea I would have asked for an instruction and a direction straight off because of issues that come to light just wasn't the way one's mind worked.
But you know that the Scottish Public Finance Manual says that as the accountable officer, the essence of the accountable officer's role is a personal responsibility for the propriety, regularity of the finances under their stewardship. So the book stops with you, doesn't it?
It did indeed. But ultimately, I was not in a position where I was saying I regard this as unwise or poor value for money or a poor judgment to enter into. We still had the outcome of the procurement, which told us this was the best bid for price and quality. And we had secured some negotiations of risk both from CMAL to Ferguson's and from ourselves with CMAL. So I didn't see how I was exposed. And indeed, I don't think that the Auditor General's report in anywhere said that I should have sought a written authority. And that's why I don't see any reason to review that now at all.
Well, the vessels are 5 years late and 2.5 times over budget, so maybe that's a reason you should reflect on it. Well, I'm going to bring Willie Coffey in.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Mr Middleton. It's in that area I want to ask a few questions, if I may, as well. Up to the point where the approval was given, there was clearly concern about the contracts, and it did not lead to anyone asking for written authority or ministerial direction. So there has to have been some kind of assurance process in that space that enabled yourselves to recommend to the ministers to proceed with the contract. And what that seems to be missing for the members of the committee and perhaps for the public is what happened in there to take us from concerns to feeling able to recommend proceeding with the contract. What happened? What did that assurance process look like to enable that advice to be given to the minister?
I think the process was, as I've outlined, and I'm sorry if it's been unclear, that discussions between Transport Scotland officials and CMAL went over the ground. The CMAL themselves sought to negotiate some of the financial risks back from the extreme position perhaps taken by Ferguson's at the outset. So whether it's the 25% and other matters, I think they're outlined in the Auditor General's report. So some of the financial issues were negotiated with Ferguson's. And then CMAL made clear that they were still uncomfortable, but that they would want assurances from government that if we proceeded, they would not be left in an exposed position themselves. And therefore, to render them, they used the word harmless, I think, in their written submission. And we therefore drew up a letter of comfort, as well as looking at our standard loan letter. And those correspondence were drawn up in consultation with CMAL, in consultation with other parts of the Scottish Government, procurement, legal, financial. And we believe that that provided us with sufficient basis to say to ministers, you are able to proceed. But in proceeding, you must, Minister, be aware of the risks that have been identified. But those risks were primarily financial. No one, I think, raised the issue of the vessels not being completed or not being built. No one suggested the yard was somehow going to be incapable of building the ships. Now, I understand perfectly well the point the convener put to me a few minutes ago, that it is not a satisfactory situation. But I don't know whether you're asking me to put myself back into the period of August, September, October 2015. And as far as we were concerned, the papers we put to ministers, I think on the 8th of October, covered the ground as far as we were able to do, both in terms of risks with Ferguson's and in terms of how we were giving comfort and reassurance to CMAL that they would not be exposed. And that was all put up to ministers so that they could take a decision on whether they were content to proceed.
So just to clarify, if all the key players at that point in the process were content, perhaps not happy, but content that the risks that we were being presented with were manageable, so everyone at that stage was content to make the recommendation to proceed?
Well, everyone within government. I mean, I understand CMAL have made their views, and I'm not seeking to disparage any views that CMAL have expressed. I mean, the word content may not be a word that they would use, but I mean, I think they accepted the reassurances. They accepted the letter of comfort which they were involved in drawing up, and they entered into the contract.
Okay. Thanks for that. For now, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Craig Hoy has got some questions to put to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr Middleton. I just want to look a little bit deeper into the issue of the builder's refund guarantee and Jim McCall's account of the discussions that he undertook with what he said was Scottish Government and CMAL in developing a bid in which he says that you knew that they were not in a position to offer a builder's refund guarantee. And that's obviously documented in relation to an exchange of letters between Stuart McMillan and Derek Mackay in February 2015, in which it is intimated that it would be possible to proceed without a full builder's refund guarantee. What was your awareness of that correspondence?
I have to be honest, I have no recollection of that correspondence, and I was not in the pile of material I was allowed to reread. That was not in that pile. Now, if you ask me to say, my recollection is zero. If someone did a trawl of the documents and proved I had seen that, then you know, you have me bound to rights. But my recollection is zero, and I did not see that in the pile of documents. So I have my awareness of that exchange between Derek Mackay and Stuart McMillan is not in my recollection at all.
Okay, so the letter of February 2015 has not been formally released to the committee, but it has been quoted in the press. And within the reports of that, Mr. Mackay gives reassurance to Mr. McMillan that it would be possible to proceed without a builder's refund guarantee. And he says, because CMAL has on occasion taken different approaches. Are you aware of any different approaches in relation to that fundamental issue of a builder's refund guarantee in relation to any prior procurements?
I couldn't quote you any. I know from some of the documents that I reread that it was quoted from some of my officials that a letter of comfort had been given in previous instances. That, I think that is stated. But I can't quote you those instances because I don't have access to the to those that could research and advise me on that. But I did read in the pile that I was permitted to look at again a reference to a letter of comfort having been used in the past. Now, again, whether that letter of comfort was used directly in relation to the builder's refund guarantee, and I do not have the paper's advice to be able to answer that. I'm sorry.
Okay. Obviously, you mentioned financial risk, but there was an element of political risk in this decision in that the contract was being awarded to a well-known businessman who was aligned to the SNP, the party of government, and the independence cause. What were your thoughts at the time about awarding such a high-profile contract to such a figure who was clearly known to have connections to the party of government?
Well, we're not politically naive, I hope. I actually think, to the extent there was a motivation to see the contract awarded, if it was possible to do so within the bounds of risk and propriety, if there was a motivation, it was simply that, you know, Ferguson's was a well-known producer in Scotland, in a part of the country which had its economic difficulties. So if there was an underlying motivation from our part to try and secure the award of the contract, it was because, you know, the importance of Ferguson's and the significance of Ferguson's was well known and well understood. The Jim McCall angle and the politics of it, I have to say, you know, we understand the awareness of that, but that was not in the forefront of our minds at all.
Okay. But you would concede there was some degree of political risk in proceeding that?
I'm not sure. Well, I think I'm not sure I'm best judged to offer a view on the political risk. I think if you can say that there was a procurement process which had Ferguson's as top for quality and price, then I think that's your best defence against any suggestion, and there could be no suggestion that the minister as a politician was trying to influence us towards Ferguson's just because of the influence of Mr. McCall.
Okay, CMAL expressed concerns to this committee about the razzmatazz, the fanfare around the preferred business status being announced, because obviously they thought at that point that it almost locked in the deal and it would bind their hands in future negotiations. Did Transport Scotland advise Scottish ministers to consider perhaps a more discreet way to achieve that milestone of preferred bidder status?
Not specifically, no. I mean, preferred bidder status, the outcome of procurements, is something we deal with quite regularly. And that point of preferred bidder, the issue, the problem with the issue of Alcatel letters, if you understand the significance of the point at which everyone's informed, and especially in a competition where you might have five or six parties informed, is when you issue letters, you know, you tell quite a lot of people, and ministers conducting business tend to like to have communications on their terms. Otherwise they get things fed back from others who say, oh, we've heard such and such. And Minister X and Minister Y says, well, I didn't know anything about that. So it was not uncommon. I mean, I understand the point you're making, but it was not uncommon. Indeed, it was relatively common other procurements for contracts for preferred bidder status to become known, and therefore for ministers to seek to publicise that on their own terms. So I think we understood that that had become part and parcel of procurement outcomes.
But this wasn't just issuing letters, this was light camera action, the First Minister. Did you have any concern that given that you hadn't got there yet and there was still this unresolved issue of the builder's refund guarantee, that you were going to compromise the further negotiations?
I mean, I don't think the negotiations were actually compromised. I mean, obviously there was razzmatazz, and in some ways in the wider... you've just asked me about political awareness and the wider politics, one can understand that. But there's plenty of times when there's post-tender negotiation and post-outcome negotiation. I mean, contractors are not always in business for charitable purposes, and they often come back at various stages to try and negotiate things. And indeed, once contracts are underway, contractors can come back and try and negotiate things. So I don't think that the publicity in and of itself prejudiced anything, but I'm not suggesting I don't understand why some in CMAL might have felt uncomfortable. Perhaps we were more used to it.
Okay, I'm now going to bring Colin Beattie in for some questions. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Ms. Middleton, I'm probably covering a little bit of ground that others have covered maybe from a different angle. Looking at your submission of 24th June, you stated in here, I do not think there was ever any suggestion of CMAL requesting a written ministerial authority. Would it have been you that would advise CMAL if a written ministerial authority was required?
Depends what you mean by advised. Sorry, I wouldn't try to dodge it. What I'm saying is they could well have come to me and asked that, and I could well have discussed it with them.
Did they do so?
No, they didn't come to me to ask for my advice.
So there was no real advice given, particularly in this case, as to whether it was required any sort of direction. From what you're saying, and please correct me, from what you're saying, it was just a routine process with a sign-off from the minister.
Well, it was routine but high profile and had a number of sensitivities, which we've discussed this morning. I mean, I wrote my note to you on the 24th of June in response to your questions. And I have in my head, as I discussed a little bit with the convener, written authority represents that quite, I hesitate to use the word nuclear option, but a very, very rare event of seeking an instruction or direction. So when you ask me, did CMAL consider that? It was never in my head at the time that they were seeking that. They were seeking other things. They were seeking reassurance. They were seeking transfer of risk. They were seeking letters of comfort. They were not saying, we will not do this under any circumstances. The only way we'll do it is if we get a direction, whatever that meant in precise terms for an NDPB. That would have raised quite a lot of questions in my mind. I thought we had, you offered the word routine, and clearly it wasn't routine. There was quite extensive discussions about how we managed risk and how we presented it in a way to the minister that we judged was acceptable to proceed. But I know CMAL have expressed their own views, and I mean I saw their submission after I wrote to you. I saw their appearance after I wrote to you, and you know they clearly had stronger feelings about whether they were in effect, I think in their written submission, effectively instructed. They also made reference to being told not to ask for a direction, which I didn't really understand. So I don't think in legal terms, and the Auditor General's report did not say that we issued an instruction or a direction. Whether they could have thought differently about the processes they might have followed and whether they might have come to me and talked further about that or talked to others, I really can't say. But I mean, I gave a kind of unequivocal response to the question you posed to me in writing, because that was the understanding of my mind at the time, that CMAL were not seeking anything analogous to what I called in my mind a written authority, which was an instruction or direction, which is, you know, really quite heavy duty.
So as far as your recollection is concerned, this was never discussed?
No.
Not within your...
Not within my ambit, no. I mean, I've heard the reference to shareholder instruction. And if that's how things are perceived, well, that's for others to say. And CMAL themselves were involved in drawing up what I think within our ambit we called the letter of comfort, the letter of reassurance. It was not a direction. It was not an instruction. If the terminology about referring to us as a shareholder made it effectively a shareholder instruction, well, I'll leave others to judge that. But in our heads, in our minds, we were not setting out to direct anybody, which is what I believe the term written authority really means. It means instruct or direct, in my head.
I think some of the terminology has been a bit confusing. Yeah. Just continuing on this, a fairly important document was the Transport Scotland's submission to ministers on the 8th of October 2015. Do you consider that made a clear case for awarding the contract to FMIL?
Yes, I do. Well, it made a clear case that ministers were in a position to authorise the award of the contract because all avenues had been explored to manage risk in such a way that we assumed was acceptable to CMAL.
So, as far as you were concerned, it's not confusing, it's not strange that the minister signed off based on the information he was given?
No.
Okay. Now, there's some differing views in the evidence that we've had on 26th May and again on the 30th of June on whether the contract award decision was down to CMAL. Do you consider that CMAL was given a direct instruction to proceed?
That's not how I would have perceived it in my mind. If someone wants to advise me that the letters amounted to a direct instruction, that would be for others to say. But in our mind, we were giving them a letter of comfort, a letter of reassurance, a letter around the where financial risks would lie if certain things unfolded. So I did not regard us as giving an instruction, no.
So as far as you're concerned, the decision on the contract award was down to CMAL. It was their decision at the end of the day.
Yes, and I think... I can't remember the precise words, but I think on the Auditor General's report, in paragraph 29, a conclusion, the CMAL Board accepted those assurances and on 16th October awarded the contracts. Mm. As far as I'm concerned, that's it.
So, as far as you're concerned, there was nothing unusual about the process that was followed?
Well, I don't...
High-profile, yes, but not unusual in terms of how it was handled.
There were sensitivities and there were issues that required to be addressed, but we gave assurances. Whether those assurances are out of kilter with a whole range of other procurements, I'd need more time to analyse. But I wouldn't go for routine and normal, but we certainly were not instructing them. In my head, in my mind, we were not instructing them.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Do you want to come in, Graham?
Okay, convener.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you very much. Mr Middleton, just going back to what you said pretty much right at the start, where you described reporting the risks to ministers, did I pick you up right that it was only Derek Mackay that was reported to?
I need to remind myself of the copy list, but I would assume that the Cabinet Secretary would be copied into that. That would be the normal practice.
So you didn't personally do the reporting? How was it done? Was it by letter or was it a discussion?
It was a written submission of just over 2 pages, which had a number of enclosures, including the most up-to-date paper from CMAL and including previous papers from CMAL, and included drafts of the amended loan letter that would go from Transport Scotland and in drafts of the letter of comfort, I'm calling it the letter of comfort, from my relevant director, John Nicholls, to the chair of CMAL. So the whole kind of story of risk how the risk was to be mitigated, and the letters that had been agreed with CMAL were presented to the minister so that we felt he was in a position to say whether he was content to approve or not.
So in your recollection, in your view, those risks would have been reported to Derek Mackay and his then boss, Keith Brown?
Yes, but they were more widely reported to officials across the Scottish Government, including procurement and finance and legal, and special advisers would be involved. So matters were quite well, you know, it was not a narrow thing. It was quite well trawled across the government machine.
And then which minister, either Mr Brown or Mr Mackay, then gave the nod to going ahead?
It was a note from Mr Mackay. I know that was the note that was not discovered until some subsequent time, and that it was his sign off to that final deal, yes.
And prior to that, of course, we had the announcement of the preferred bidder status. Which minister was involved in that?
Well, from recollection, Keith Brown, I think, had to see that advice in August because Derek Mackay, I think, was away on annual leave.
Okay.
But I mean, the practice within any portfolio, the cabinet secretary decides the issues on which he or she will lead on, and therefore take direct decisions on, and the cabinet secretary will decide which issues are led on by their relevant juniors, the ministers. But all papers are, I think, almost always copied to both offices.
Okay. So one final question from me, convener. What leaps out from the Auditor General's report is that despite the risks being reported, we actually don't know why ministers took the decision they did, and the Auditor General said when he wrote the report there was no documentary evidence. Do you know why ministers ignored the reservations from CMAL?
I don't think they ignored them. They stated they were aware of them. My view is, and I think you have an opportunity to ask this more directly later, is that Mr Mackay saw the advice of 8th October, understood it clearly. Indeed, he said some of this in writing. It's on your website, I think. He understood the advice. He understood what was explained to him. He understood how risks had been managed in various ways to mitigate risk to CMAL in particular. And he therefore felt able to sign off the approval to award the contract.
Okay. Thanks, convener.
Just on that point, on the 9th of October, one of the final emails in the collection was sent at 17:15, and it's from Ainsley McLaughlin saying, "I just finished my call with DFM. He now understands the background and that Mr Mackay has cleared the proposal, so the way is clear to award." So the Deputy First Minister, either as the Deputy First Minister or as the Cabinet Secretary for Finance at the time, was involved right at the point of decision. And the email before that says, "Would you drop a note in the system to confirm the absence of banana skins after your call with the DFM, please?" What would the banana skins be?
Well, banana skins, I think, is probably just a flippant term for anything that might conceivably go wrong. Now, given where we are with the ships, I don't wish to make any flippancy about the use of that terminology. I mean, the decision had been taken by Mr Mackay. The DFM, as Finance Secretary at the time, it would be perfectly normal and not inconsistent with other issues for the Finance Secretary to want to be aware of things and to be clear about things. And I mean, his own officials were on the copy list for a number of the submissions. So I appreciate from where you are, this may seem something of great significance. I don't think for us in the system, the DFM just cross-checking at the final stage that he was content and understood what was going on. I don't think that was abnormal in our context of business. And I don't think it was something that should lead you down, you know, some other routes of thinking. There's some great clever game going on here. I think just in an organisation where there's collective responsibility within the Scottish Government, the Deputy First Minister and Finance Secretary was an extremely important person, and he took an interest across all matters, and he therefore just wanted some, well, I don't know what was in the phone call between Ainsley McLaughlin and himself, but he just wanted some final reassurance, and that was done, and there we are.
So why did Roy Brannan tell this committee on the 26th of May, and I quote him, if it was a transport project, it will be a decision entirely for the Transport Minister?
Well, I'm afraid, you know, I can't speak for Roy Brannan. I mean, in a sense, in ministerial decision terms, that's true. The fact that the DFM takes an interest in matters doesn't mean that he somehow pulls every decision. I mean, if it had been the case, and here I am speculating, purely speculating, if Ainsley McLaughlin had told them something and John Swinney thought, I don't like the sound of that, then I guess the next thing would have been a phone call between the DFM and Derek Mackay. And either at that point something else would have been done, or else Derek Mackay would have said, it's OK, DFM, this is my reasoning, and DFM might say, well, that's fine, OK. Now, again, all that speculation, but I don't think that detracts from what Roy was saying, that transport ministers decide transport business within the portfolio, whether that's the Cabinet Secretary as Keith Brown, or whether it's the Minister as Derek Mackay, they decide things. If other ministers want to query, or other ministers want to clarify a point, and the Finance Secretary is always an important person, then that can happen. I don't think that necessarily dilutes where decision-making lies.
But I suppose the critical point is the language used, where Mr Brannan told us that it will be a decision entirely for the Transport Minister, and the evidence appears to suggest otherwise. Do you have any final comment on that?
No, I don't think there is actually a gulf in what Roy said and what you're noting from the record of emails with DFM. I don't think there is actually a gulf, but I understand why you're posing the question.
OK. Mr Middleton, thank you very much for your evidence this morning. We appreciate your time and your written submission. And if anything else occurs to you after you leave the room or your recollection expands, then please don't hesitate to contact us and put in writing anything that you think would be helpful to the pursuit of our inquiry. But I'm now going to suspend the committee as we have a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Well, can I welcome everybody back to the next session of the Public Audit Committee's meeting this morning. In the second half of our evidence gathering today, we are pleased to welcome Derek Mackay, who has given us a written submission, but is also here to answer questions that the committee wishes to pose. Mr. Mackay, of course, you were formerly Minister for Transport and the Islands, and also Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution, and it may be that we'll ask you questions related to both of your roles. But can I invite you, first of all, to make a short opening statement?
Okay, thank you, Convener, and good morning. And can I thank the committee for inviting me to attend today? I've followed your proceedings, as well as the Auditor-General's report and the REC committee findings from the previous Parliament. To answer your questions as comprehensively as possible, I've sought access to government papers I would have seen at the time as a minister, and of course will respect the rules that govern that access. Much information is already in the public domain or has been presented as evidence, and therefore I don't believe I will infringe any commercial confidentiality or protocol in being as open as possible. The REC committee has identified procurement and management failures, catastrophic failures, and of course I take my share of responsibility. However, in doing so, I believe that at every stage and in every decision, I acted with the best of intentions, with the interest of island communities, workers, Scottish shipbuilding and communities that relied upon their success foremost in my mind. As vessel construction entered difficulty, I set out the objectives to complete the vessels, safeguard the workforce and give the yard a future. These are objectives I do not regret, and I believe that Ferguson's is still operational today with a future because of the objectives set at the time. My responsibilities, as you say, Convener, were as Transport and Islands Minister from November 2014 to May 2016, and then as Finance and subsequently also Economy Secretary thereafter until February 2020. I am speaking in a personal capacity and do welcome the opportunity to supplement my evidence and answer your questions to the best of my ability.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I begin by asking you something quite particular in the written submission that you submitted to us on the 23rd of June? And that is around events on the 31st of August, where an announcement was made that Ferguson's were being awarded preferred bidder status. And you said in your written submission, press release and coverage at the time would have stated the award would be subject to ongoing negotiations. Therefore, I do not believe the announcement would have undermined CMAL's negotiating position. But the BBC piece, for example, which was the one tweeted by the First Minister, said, quoted her as saying, "This is an excellent result for Ferguson Marine Engineering Limited, and I am delighted to name them as preferred tenderer for the contract. The contract will see the 150-strong workforce retained and more staff taken on at the shipyard." You said on that date, "This is a significant investment that proves Scottish shipbuilding can succeed in a competitive market, etc., etc." I mean, there is no suggestion there other than that this was a done deal.
At that stage, Ferguson's had been identified as the preferred bidder. That's the fact. There were ongoing negotiations, so everything would have been subject to those ongoing negotiations. No, it wasn't a done deal, of course, until the papers were finalised and the contract was signed later in October.
OK. Can I take you back then to the 20th of August 2015? You were on leave at the time, but a letter, an email was sent to Keith Brown as the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure Investment and Cities. That email covered a range of things, Jim McCall's position and so on. But it also spoke about presentational issues. And in that it said that you, as the Minister for not only transport but the islands, was the person that was to lead on the announcement that would subsequently be made. But as we know now, you didn't lead on it, the First Minister led on it. Can you tell us what happened in those intervening days?
Do you mean from the period of that submission and
The First Minister made that announcement at the Yard rather than you?
On the 31st?
Yeah.
That was the period, as you've just heard from David Middleton, the former Chief Executive of Transport Scotland, that I was on annual leave. So that's why this paper, which was sent to the Cabinet Secretary to deal with, was approved by him. Happy to cover the decisions that I have taken. That paper was approved by the Cabinet Secretary. And I returned from leave, I think, that week around the 31st. As it happens, Convener, I'd like to correct something you've said in your previous submissions, that I was accompanying the First Minister. She was accompanying me. I was actually at Glasgow Airport that day on the 31st as part of the airport extension of a pier. So I wasn't at the presentation of Ferguson's as the preferred bidder on the 31st. What I would also say is, over that period, that is the period I was on annual leave. So that's, you know, you're asking me what was going on during that time. Yes, I think there's a quote from me in the press release. You would expect that, would you not, from the Minister for Transport in the Islands. But over that period, I was on annual leave.
Okay, but you were back from annual leave on the 31st. It's just that you were not at Port Glasgow.
That's correct.
Okay. Right, I'm going to bring in other members of the committee now who've got questions to put to you, starting with Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Mackay. Thank you for appearing before us. In his report, the Auditor-General identifies a major issue in relation to insufficient documentary evidence, and that's been a concern for this committee. Subsequent to the report appearing, there was documentary evidence to suggest that you were responsible, and that was the release that came out to suggest that you were responsible for taking the decision. So we now know who took the decision, but we don't know why. Do you think there is still some documentary evidence out there that may give us further information as to why the decision was taken to announce Ferguson as the preferred bidder, and B, then to award the contract, despite the misgivings around a full builder's refund guarantee?
Oh, can I thank Mr. Hoy for the question? To be direct, I don't think there's any further paperwork around that date of the submission on the 8th of August that was presented to me on the issues and the risks, and then the decision that I took. Now, there is 8 volumes, of course, of information in this matter, as you would expect. I think it was actually in December 2019 when I, as Cabinet Secretary, instructed the information released so that the government could be as transparent as possible. But I don't have the ability to cross-check every document that's in the public domain with what has maybe happened over the last few years. But no, I don't think there's any further documentation around the decision that was taken on the 8th of August that is missing. And I have looked at my own records, everything that... Well, ministers can't retain records. I've had access to government papers to try and reassure myself of that, that there's no further documentation that I could provide you with.
OK. In relation to, obviously, preferred bidder status, CMAL is a concern at that point onwards. It was almost seen as a done deal. Before you left on holiday, what status was that decision at? Would you have approved it had you been in the office rather than on leave?
So the period at which I was on annual leave was at the preferred bidder status. The papers came up for that decision on the 20th of August. And as you've heard, Keith Brown made that decision. And then on my return, I considered the papers that came to me.
OK. But prior to you going, did you get the impression that that's the direction of travel, that the preferred bidder status was going towards FPL, and were you comfortable with that?
No, I don't think there was any step for a hint. I would have been briefed, as you would expect, that submissions would be forthcoming to ministers to expect that. But I was on annual leave, and, you know, that's just a matter of fact. But I was advised that papers would be forthcoming at some point. Of course, it was in the hands of civil servants when submissions were presented to us for decision.
Yeah. Were you aware of any cabinet-level discussions around the decision to award preferred bidder status to FML?
No, at that point I wasn't a member of cabinet. I was appointed to cabinet when I became finance secretary in 2016. So I'm not aware of what discussions there might have been at cabinet.
But there could have been discussions?
There could have been, and that's entirely possible.
Okay. Did you get the impression that the First Minister was actively involved in the negotiations at that stage, or at least was being well briefed about the discussions to reach that preferred bidder status?
I can't speak for, you know, how much the First Minister knew other than the copy lists that I've seen in submissions put to ministers, which is largely to Cabinet Secretary, as you've heard from David Middleton, or myself. So it's a bit unfair to ask me what information the First Minister may have known, because I don't know what she was briefed on in relation to preferred bidder status, but I can't imagine that she would have been personally involved beyond what her ministers were doing on the subject.
But in terms of the culture of government, it appears to be quite tight. It would be safe to assume that there was channels of communication.
There are formal channels of communication, you know, cabinet meetings or meetings with other ministers. As Transport Minister, as you would expect, I would speak to my Cabinet Secretary and engage with him on matters of importance. So, you know, most government business is conducted through the formal channels and written paperwork, communication, submissions, notes, memos, and the sharing of submissions and responses.
Yeah. There is an issue here, of course, which is that the proposed contractor was somebody who did have close personal connections to your party, to the independence movement, and therefore the party of government. What was your personal relationship with Mr McCall like?
Well, Mr McCall was a member of the Council of Economic Advisers and clearly a very high-profile businessman in Scotland, and was a member of other government fora. So that was my relationship with Mr McCall, as it would be with anyone of his significance in the business community. And as a finance secretary, I would have engaged with him through the Council of Economic Advisers.
But given the widespread media reporting that he was perhaps close to the party, did you foresee any political risk in that? Could that be one of the banana skins that you wanted to clear?
No, I mean, nobody was ever compromised on that matter. And, you know, the decision to award the contract to Ferguson's was based on Ferguson's bid, nothing else.
OK. CMAL said that they didn't attend the ceremony for preferred bidder status, as you didn't, we found out today, because they had concerns that it would compromise the negotiation position further, critically around the builder's refund guarantee. In hindsight, what's your view on that?
So I wasn't aware of that at the time, because, again, I would have been on annual leave from that period of Ferguson's appointment as preferred bidder up until the visit on the 31st of August. So in my evidence, I've clearly said I thought it had no impact on the negotiations, because I didn't believe, you know, when I've been asked the question by the committee, do you think it had any impact on the negotiations? And I've said no, because of the, you know, the submission I've put in my evidence. Now, clearly, CMAL have said something different in their evidence, but that wasn't something I was aware of at the time, that they felt the way that they did, as they've expressed to evidence to you. That was not conveyed to me. But in any event, as I've answered the convener, that's not a subject on which I was engaged, because at that point, I was on annual leave.
Okay. Obviously, you weren't there for the unveiling of preferred bidder status. It did say, however, that you would be taking the lead on that announcement, and then subsequently something changed. Would it have been the First Minister's office's decision to press for this to be announced at a kind of high-profile, kind of photo shoot style event, rather than just, as Mr Middleton said, the issuing of the usual contractual letters?
Again, you're asking me something that happened in my absence, and I'm not cited on the exchanges that might have been going on at the time. But yes, I did lead on the announcement, on the decisions, on my return to the subject, my return to business. CMAL has provided their view on how the visit has come about, and, you know, they've said it hasn't come from the Transport Minister's office, because, you know, I wasn't there on the day.
Are you a bit concerned that you weren't there for preferred bidder status, but everything seems to have hung on that decision, and that since effectively what happened afterwards was almost a fait accompli? And are you concerned that the Scottish Government and the First Minister, in light of documents like this that come to light, that you're being lined up to be the fall guy here, that this is Operation Blame Derek Mackay?
I said in my opening remarks to committee that I'll take my share of responsibility and I'll answer robustly any decision that I have taken, and I take my share of responsibility. But equally, I recognise the catastrophic failure at Ferguson's to complete the vessels on time and on budget. That is deeply regrettable. But what I don't regret, convener, is protecting the workforce and ensuring that the yard was supported, it has a future, and that we were able to support Scottish shipbuilding. So I can answer for my decisions and my involvement. I was a proactive minister and I did carefully consider all the submissions and happy to explain through the rationale of every single one, whilst also taking my share of responsibility.
And who else has a stake or a share in that responsibility, would you say?
According to the Auditor-General and the previous REC committee in the previous Parliament, there are multiple failings. So I don't think it all rests on me, but other people have advised that clearly there are multiple failings here. But I'm taking my share of responsibility. I was the lead minister.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sharon Dowie has some questions for you. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Mackay. Following on from Craig's questions, was the decision to award the ferry contract to FMEL in any way linked to political calculations or dictated by a political timescale?
No.
In your opinion, no?
In my opinion, absolutely not.
Okay. Do you think there was an error in rushing to the decision made to meet a political agenda? You're saying that you don't think there was one, but the UK government's announcement on defence contracts and to make this a top-line announcement at your party's conference. So do you think that was a political agenda?
Can I say to Ms Dowie that I'm going to resist any petty politics, any comparing with the UK government and any procurement decisions they may have taken about any matter, and stick to just answering your questions on the subject. I don't think there was a political agenda. I don't think it was rushed at all. I don't think there was any evidence it was rushed. It was a methodical approach to procurement, and I've recognised the failure of it, but it was made with the best of intentions. Processes were followed, and no, I don't think it was rushed, and I don't think it was a partisan decision. It was a decision about trying to ensure we could get two vessels complete, as it happens, built in Scotland, and ensuring the future of the yard and growing the workforce at the yard, which actually was a consequence of the decision. No, so I don't think there was any partisanship in it or wrongdoing, as is suggested.
Well, I think we heard from Mr McCall that he thought there was a future for the yard even without that ferry contract, and there was a rush to put the announcement out because the negotiations were still going on, which CMAL felt hindered them in their negotiations, and it would have been harder for the government to go and pull back from that announcement after having made such a high-profile announcement that the contract was going there. But anyway, moving on.
Can I answer the question, though, convener, because charges are put, and I'm happy to answer.
I'm happy to let you answer.
So I don't, to be honest, believe that anything was rushed. In fact, there were extensions in part of the process, so more time was taken. There was no rush. There was no artificial deadline. I do remember saying, once the decision had been taken, though, now let's get on with it. You know, decision's taken, let's move on, you know, and act as swiftly as possible. But there was no rush to the decision-making. There was no rush for any reason whatsoever. This was a methodical approach to get the right decision around the procurement of these vessels. And there is no evidence. I haven't seen the Auditor-General or anyone else other than Mr McCall say that he felt there was a rush, but the evidence shows the timelines and the milestones set out to conduct this in a proper fashion.
Okay, well, I'll maybe disagree, because I think that we could maybe have waited until you come back your holidays for you to sign the contract, rather than it being Keith Brown that signed it while you were on holiday. But anyway, moving on.
Just as a point of fact, convener, ministers don't sign contracts, but if we're going to be absolutely factually correct, I will be absolutely factually correct.
He was asked to approve it, though, wasn't he?
Yeah, that's different from signing it, yes. I'm just being clear about signing, because I saw a lot of parliamentary debate around who signed the contract. Ministers don't ordinarily sign contracts.
Okay. On that point, then, who signed the contract?
it would have been officials from CMAL, because ultimately CMAL was leading the procurement process on behalf of, you know, Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government. And then, of course, for FML, it would have been, well, essentially their director signing, wouldn't it?
OK. So, on the point where the contract was awarded, did you know at that time that CMAL had concerns about the awarding of the contract to, and were you aware of how much concern they had?
Well, the submission to me on the 8th of October, I think, quite comprehensively outlines their concerns, and that was a decision, that was a submission to me to consider the information that had been presented, but crucially in that to give authorisation to proceed. So that submission outlined their concerns, and they did have concerns primarily, well, in fact, really only around the builder's refund guarantee, and I'm happily I'll talk through the rationale of how I believe that those risks were mitigated, but the submission to me outlined that the request from me as Minister was to proceed, so it wasn't to revisit, to reject or go through an options appraisal or to restart the process. It was a recommendation to proceed, to give CMAL the necessary authorisation to proceed, and then it outlined, having raised all the concerns from CMAL about the lack of a full builder's refund guarantee, the ways in which those fears could be allayed. The report talks about the best deal in the circumstances, how we could best address the concerns of CMAL. Government lawyers had been advised and contained, SG Finance, procurement, it fairly assessed the risks here. It spoke of similar problems can arise even where a full builder's refund guarantee is in place, and ultimately asked me if I was content to proceed, and I was, considering, as you've heard from David Middleton and indeed his successor Roy Brannan, Chief Executive of Transport Scotland, that the information submitted showed that there had been progress from the worst point, I think, of negotiations between CMAL and FML to a far more satisfactory position. So much so, CMAL, we've heard, subsequently co-produced the note that came to me. They co-produced the risk assessment that came to me, but as a submission for me to give authorisation to proceed with the process, and I'm happy to go into more detail as to what was in that submission.
Right, so you weren't concerned then at this point that you didn't have the full builder's refund guarantee?
Well, of course I was concerned, because the papers give reason to be concerned, but it also gives the mitigations to be taken into account to make a balanced decision. That's exactly what I did. So the paper was asking for my recommendation in the affirmative and the positive. Do we have permission to proceed? You know, and now, the interpretation that I got from this is that the matters under negotiation had been resolved at the point I was presented with the submission, because of the narration of the issues and the reassurances within it. And, you know, I've seen elsewhere in the CMAL evidence that they claim not to have put in a recommendation, positive or negative. But then, of course, in evidence, they've said subsequently that they didn't really want to award the contract. But the paper that I was considering was asking exactly for that, for authorisation to proceed, notwithstanding the concerns that they had raised. I felt there was the necessary mitigations to address that. And I'm also aware that a full BRG, builder's refund guarantee, is not the panacea. It doesn't ensure that there will be no issues in both procurement or indeed the build-out. And it is really curious when you look at the note, that the note didn't suggest that Ferguson's was incapable of building these vessels, or even that there was a high risk that they were going to be late or that the contractor wouldn't perform. The risk was around the financing, the builder's refund guarantee, because FML was a relatively new financial entity, but the shipyard was already well established and had been producing vessels for the CalMac fleet. So I was looking at the assessment, the history, the confidence in the yard, the fact that the evaluation exercise showed that FML came out on top as overall, you know, bidder. So there was a lot of reasons to have reassurance and confidence in the submission that had been put to me. Of course, CMAL were concerned. They were right to be concerned in that they felt they would be carrying a lot of risk as their own corporate organisation, and that's fair, and that's therefore why Transport Scotland, with with the support of ministers, then offered that letter of comfort, which, as you've heard in evidence, was co-produced. So it was co-produced to the point that Transport Scotland thought they were recommending to me that they were seeking approval to proceed. You've now got two former chief executives of Transport Scotland confirming that, and for completeness, the Director General and equivalent of Economy at the time. That was the understanding of the submission put to me.
Yep, there still seems to be a lot of concerns from CMIL, who felt as if they were maybe forced into it. So with all the different concerns that were raised to you, did you discuss that with any other ministers or cabinet secretaries or indeed the First Minister or the First Minister's advisers?
No,
on the concerns.
Well, 2 points there. First of all, you have said, Ms Dowie, that CMIL felt forced. That was the word you used. And I think, you know, I can see how you might get that impression from the more recent evidence we've had from CMIL, but can I refer you to the evidence they gave to the REC committee? Asked directly whether the Scottish Government or Transport Scotland had ever applied pressure, either directly or indirectly, for CMIL to award the ferries contract to a particular bidder, Kevin Hobbs was categorical in his response that this had not happened and the contract had been awarded to FMIL purely based on evaluation of the quality and price of its bid and past reputation. So, you know, I would challenge some of the evidence that's maybe emerged from CMIL just based on what they've said before. I didn't have discussions with other ministers because I didn't think it was necessary at the point of the submission on the 8th of October. I received the advice, I considered the advice, I was satisfied with the advice for the reasons that I've given, and therefore I informed private office, my private office, to proceed, that I was content with the paper that I had received.
Okay, thanks. A letter between yourself and Stuart McMillan suggests that CMIL had been comfortable to proceed with other procurement and ship builds without a full builder's guarantee, something that Eric Ostergaard said in his evidence wasn't true. But can you say more about the letter? And would you be willing to share it with the committee? Do you have a copy of this letter?
But the issue about correspondence between me as a minister and an individual MSP at the time, I think former ministers are not allowed to retain government papers, so no, I'm not in a position to share anything that's not already in the public domain. But of course, I'm more than happy for communication to be released by whoever has it. So I have no difficulty with that whatsoever, but it would be me breaching rules of access to correspondence that I've had access to in a restricted environment to then share that. So I'd be quite happy if that communication was released. It doesn't give me any difficulty whatsoever if I can then explain what the communication would have been doing. You know, an MSP's inquires to me about then, or actually the letter was to Scottish Government, it was to Cabinet Secretary John Swinney about FMIL or Ferguson's, the procurement process, and I was responding. Now, I responded in the terms that would have been drafted for me. So the way ministerial correspondence works, as I'm sure you're aware, MSP writes to Minister, a draft letter is produced by the civil service, and then either amended, approved, rejected, whatever, and then sent to the member. So I was satisfied that the information I was sending to the MSP, the MSP at the time, was addressing a concern that they had. So I responded as minister to an individual MSP, and I think that that's what you would expect of a minister. Now, that is confidential communication between a minister and a constituent MSP, but if people wish to share that and there's permission to do so, I have no difficulty with that whatsoever.
Can I just pick that point up? Because you've told us already this morning that you were a proactive minister. So I don't really think it's satisfactory to rely on a civil service draft as a reason for that letter going out, which said that the builder's refund guarantee was a preference, that the CMIL board had a preference for refund guarantees. It has, on occasion, taken alternative approaches. Because Jim McCall told us, and I quote him, that gave us the green light to go ahead. and put the resources into putting the tender. There is a lot of work that goes into tenders, and we were not going to go ahead and do all of that if we were not going to be allowed to negotiate a different form of guarantee. So how appropriate do you think it is, in the middle of a tender process, for you to send that kind of letter as the minister?
Well, if you look at the timing of the letter, the reason I made the point about the civil service convener, I signed the letter, it's my letter to a constituent MSP. What I'm describing, though, is that letter would have been composed. For those that are familiar with ministerial office, you receive a draft letter, you often get advice with the communication, the original letter, and then you can either amend, reject, or send a letter. So, yes, I sent the letter, and everything in it is information that I would have been advised is true at the time. And this morning, I think, helpfully, you've heard from David Middleton, who, as part of Transport Scotland, said that behind that letter would have been a background information that previously letters of comfort had been issued. Now, I assume that was in relation to Builders Refund Guarantee. Now, I can't then go through, well, where else was, you know, this flexibility given? But the advice I would have been given at the time would have been that that would be accurate to put in a letter, and that was a letter between, as I say, me and an MSP. I didn't send the letter to anyone else. I responded to a member of the Scottish Parliament as a minister at the time, based on the information I had and the draft that I would assume, having been composed and drafted by officials, is accurate and confident that the substance of that could be verified.
You've talked about other evidence we've received which you think revises the history book a little bit. But, I mean, you've said in your written submission to the committee that you were first aware of the guarantees issue following the selection of preferred bidder. But that correspondence from February of 2015 suggests you were aware of that issue much earlier.
No, I think it's two separate issues. I in no way got involved in that issue in relation to CMAL's procurement exercise. The question that was put to me was when did I first become aware? Your committee's question to me is at what stage in the procurement process did you first become aware that FML was unable to offer a full builder's refund guarantee? It's true to say that that was after the selection as preferred bidder and in detail on the submission in the 8th of August. I had no engagement with CMAL, as they, you know, I'm sure would confirm in their processes throughout that time. Indeed, that letter, as they've also confirmed, was not sent to CMAL.
Yeah, but CMAL have also told us that they offered to meet with you to talk about their concerns, which were clearly still live and outstanding come that second week in October. Why didn't you take that offer up?
I would say again, convener, that I was reassured by the information and the submission to me that the issues had been resolved, that the recommendation that was being put to me was in the affirmative to proceed, to give that authorisation to proceed, not to reject, not to reconsider. The co-produced submission to me had the risk analysis. And incidentally, of course, when ministers consider decisions, there's often a risk analysis, and there is the risk of challenging most decisions that a government takes. But I was convinced by the information that I had that it was a satisfactory process, which I won't repeat the evidence I gave earlier around the mitigations, the convincing argument, the tender bids being the best overall. And if CMAL's actual request was not to proceed, that should have been what featured in a submission to me. It was not.
OK, well, they, as you know, they've taken a different view in evidence that they've submitted to us. Can I just ask you one final thing before I bring in Willie Coffey? Going back to the letter of comfort and the voted loan, I mean, the voted loan's value was £106 million, I think, and the value of the tender was £97 million. Who was party to decisions about the issuing of the letter of comfort and agreeing to the voted loan of that scale?
The submission would have been in the 8th of August, and then the letter would have been signed thereafter by officials. Is that what you're driving at, convener?
No, what I'm trying to understand is, did you have to sign off the voted loan decision?
The drafts were in the submission on the 8th of October. So in essence, in making the decision, I had that copied into the pack at the time.
But, I mean, for example, would that have gone to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance? Would that have gone to the DG Finance? Would that have gone to the Cabinet?
I don't think so, because I was lead minister and that's the kind of detail that would be dealt with by officials. So I don't think that kind of submission or that annex to a submission would have been sent to others. The copy list is on the papers at the time in terms of the politicians involved.
So but you're saying the transfer of risk from CMAL to FMEL, from FMEL to CMAL and then to the Scottish Government would have been taken by officials with no political sign-off?
No, I'm not saying that at all, Convener. What you asked is individual officials, technical...
No, I'm asking
letter.
Who signed off that voted loan decision, to your knowledge?
The decision is in the 8th of October to proceed with the letter of comfort and the financial background that goes with it. You know, I would want to look at the papers to give you an absolutely... accurate answer. So the papers that I'm looking at, incidentally, is nothing exclusive. It's just what's in the public domain. And so I'm looking at it right now, draft voted loan letter from Transport Scotland setting out an agreement to fund the two new 100-metre vessels to be built at FMEL. So the draft letters were in the pack on the 8th of October in the submission to me, which, of course, I approved the decision, and then further refinement or discussion would have gone on with CMAL and FMEL up to the point of contract award, which was, of course, later in October. Does that help?
Yeah, but if I can just very briefly ask you, as a former Cabinet Secretary for Finance, would you not have had any involvement in that kind of decision as the Cabinet Secretary for Finance?
Not specifically and individually in a specific element of it. What any finance secretary would have wanted to have known is overall budget and whatever risks were involved. And I've seen discussion around that, but I'm not saying for a minute that anyone else would have been engaged in the detail other than the officials. Having seen the draft in the submission to me on the 8th of October, and the copy list includes the Cabinet Secretary for infrastructure investment in cities, who of course was my cabinet secretary at the time. But of course you would expect DG Finance, so the officials in finance, Scottish Government Legal Directorate and Scottish Government Procurement to be involved as well to make sure everything's in order. Of course you would.
Okay, well we may investigate that a little bit more deeply, but I'm going to turn to Willie Coffey, who's got some questions to put to you.
Thanks Willie. Very much, Convener, and good morning, Derek. I just wanted to unpick a wee bit, if you don't mind, and the committee doesn't mind, the nature and substance of the assurance that was given to you to allow you to proceed to award the contract. Is it submissions of a nature just simply saying, we assure you everything is okay, Minister, or are there technical documents in that assurance framework containing information and technical advice and guidance and so forth and evidence? What is the substance of the assurance that you read to enable you to make the award?
I think there was a great deal of reassurance, but some of it would have been to say that there would be a monitoring arrangements, there would be oversight. So without seeing all the detail of that, you're reassured as a minister that there is an assurance framework. You know, there's also contract compliance arrangements, which we may come back to. But there's enough reassurance in the paper to show that there's the mechanisms in place to hold a contractor to account. Now, clearly in decisions that ministers would make, as you're making the decision and then officials get on with their area of expertise. But you know, I was quite satisfied with the risk analysis that I saw in the mitigations have been put in place, that it satisfied in my mind that CMAL could be authorised to proceed, again for many of the reasons that I've already given. Can I reflect on one thing? I mean, I think this is important. In the risk analysis, it said that the risk of lateness or poor performance was low, so no one was saying Ferguson's couldn't build the vessels. Where there was more concern was around this builder's refund, full builder's refund guarantee. Actually, despite that evidence, the opposite has turned out to be the case. The vessels are late and have overrun, regrettably, but there's actually no legal challenge to this date to the decision itself. So, you know, some of CMAL's concerns, rightly made, you make a judgment based on what you've been presented it with. Again, key comments in the submission to me, this was the best deal that could be negotiated. It was broadly comparable with the tender specification. You know, legal, finance, procurement are all content. Therefore, proceed to contract award. And it's true to say this, of course, follows the whole evaluation process, where people talked about how impressed they were by Ferguson's bid at the evaluation process, and also that it came out on top in terms of the overall scoring, and particularly on quality. So I was reassured with the mechanisms within. And of course, you would expect regular updates. Now, I wasn't Transport Minister beyond 2016, and I'm quite sure, in fact, I know that the Transport Minister would then have been updated on progress. And of course, I re-engaged on the subject as Finance Secretary because there were emerging concerns about the contract. So those triggers of concern did come into action. And then, of course, there are many, many further issues to be addressed.
So all the key players, I asked Mr Middleton this earlier, Derek, the key players that were involved in giving you that recommendation must surely also have been similarly assured that what they were saying to you was deliverable.
Oh, absolutely. And I think you heard that from David Middleton, the former Transport Scotland chief executive at the time. And then, of course, his successors looked through all the paperwork and picked up the issue on his appointment as Transport Scotland chief executive, and has also given you that in evidence that that's what they believed they were advising me. Now, it's for a minister to then make a judgment and decide, and that's what I did. Mm.
The key component that's perhaps missing in the process is probably, possibly, about the ability of the yard to deliver the ships. I mean, hindsight is a wonderful thing, we all know, but why wouldn't there be in that process some kind of assessment about the actual ability of the yard to complete the vessels on time, on budget, because we know that's what's happened since. So where was the assurance around that, about their ability to complete it? Where was that in the process?
Yeah, it was a fair question. I'm sure it would have been taken into account as part of the evaluation of the bid, the expertise that they had. Bearing in mind that Ferguson's had been constructing vessels for the CalMac fleet for years, and many of the vessels in the current CalMac fleet, ageing as they are, were built at Ferguson, so it had a track record of delivery. So that, as well as all the information that would have been in the tender, one member of CMAL said, I think it was one of the best bids that they had ever seen. It was of an exceptionally, I'm paraphrasing, high quality. So, of course, there was divided opinion within CMAL, but it was referenced as a very strong bid. So all the evaluation exercises before, to get to the preferred bidder status, to come through the PQQ and everything else, would have got to you to a point that there was confidence in the yard because of the case at the bid that they had put in, and also the fact that they had been completing vessels for CalMac through CMAL as the contracting agency previously.
Mm-hmm. Can you think of any other additional process of assurance that could have, should have taken place in the process that may have helped us to avoid where we arrive at today? What could we possibly have done at that time to try to avoid the circumstances that we find ourselves in?
Well, I think you've got a volume of recommendations from the Auditor General and the REC Committee to helpfully suggest how this is better handled in the future. And I would support, of course, I'm only an individual private citizen, but I think there are many recommendations as to how things could be improved in the future. A personal view is also that transport governance as it stands at the moment, and as I had at the time as Transport Minister, wasn't perfect. So that's also a point that I think that's made by the REC Committee and their recommendations, that I think there's definitely room for improvement into the transport governance at the time, between the agencies and the structures and so on. And there, of course, is also the potential to restructure things in a fashion where you remove that competitive, contractual, conflicting, you know, hostile, ultimately, relationship that we got into between contractor and the contracting body, then, of course, with the government into the bargain. So I think there are recommendations that have been made by others that should be adopted to ensure that this doesn't happen again.
OK. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. Colin Beattie has some questions to put. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Derek.
Morning.
I'd like to start with, there's a lot being made of possible relationships between Mr. McCall and the government because of his alleged political views. I mean, to what extent are contractors' political views taken into account when allocating contracts?
Not at all.
And are there robust processes to ensure that doesn't take place?
Absolutely, but there'd be no way that that would be taken into account whilst making a contracting decision, a procurement decision. Absolutely not.
And in your personal case, did you have any communications directly with Mr. McCall during the procurement process?
As I said in my evidence, it's very difficult, not having the diaries in front of me, to say how often I would have met with Mr. McCall. So I would have engaged with him through the Council of Economic Advisers or meetings that were diaried, or a telephone. I think there was a telephone call arranged, but I think you've got access to all that information. It's on the government's information release. But there was absolutely no inappropriate involvement or preferential treatment to Jim McCall. I think Jim McCall's been quite effusive in saying that he doesn't feel as if he was treated particularly well by the Scottish Government, so I don't think that would surprise you.
Now, it's well known that there were disputes between CMAL and FMAL, which seem to have been fairly extreme. Now, what discussions did you have with other ministers, or what actions did you explore to try and resolve this dispute and bring them together? Because mediation didn't go anywhere.
Yeah, well, I said to the convener earlier I was a very proactive minister, so even beyond my term as Transport Minister, I re-engaged as Finance and Economy Secretary, because when it was clear there were problems emerging in the contract and the lateness of the vessels and potential cost overruns, there was also the risk to the workforce, 400 workers and their families. There was a risk to the yard, there was a risk to the future of the yard. So I was regularly involved in my capacity as Finance Secretary, of course, looking after the finances of the government and the fulfilment of the contract. Clearly, other ministers would have been involved. There have been a number of transport ministers, but it would have been primarily Hamza Yousaf at first as Transport Minister and then Paul Wheelhouse as Transport Minister that I dealt with. So, of course, engaged with other ministers to try and ensure that we got a resolution to the difficulties as they emerged. Mediation, expert determination, other intervention proved unsuccessful in that we couldn't get them started because of the relationship breakdown or lack of agreement around remit or mediator. And then ultimately, as you've heard in evidence from others, no legal basis in which to proceed, which became a key issue in why further mediation couldn't have been taken forward. So I was proactive in trying to resolve the issues, and then, of course, that then led to me being involved as Finance Secretary around other matters, such as in the loans.
Now, this committee's heard that drawdowns were made against milestones. Now, subsequent to your departure, there was a report in December 2020 from the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, which clearly highlighted that these milestones were, I'm not sure I'm picking the right word, but artificially achieved. So they would pick a milestone, cutting metal, whatever, and achieving that particular piece without having all the bits up to that point actually in place, but because they had achieved that milestone, they could claim the money, and there was no way in which payment could be refused because CMAL took legal advice on that. Now, clearly, that's all part and parcel of the dispute, and I don't know the extent to which you might have been aware of that or involved during that period.
Well, CMAL would have led on the milestone arrangements largely at the outset of the contract. I remember becoming involved when it was put to me that the milestone payments, and I'm not dismissing what the REC committee has actually found on the milestone payments, although FMEL and Jim McCall object and disagree with what CMAL have said around that matter. But my view is, further down the line, when there was clear issues with Ferguson's and FMEL being able to proceed, that we had to try and find some further flexibility, some further support to assist with the issue of construction and cash flow and payment of suppliers, so on and so forth. And these would have been considerations in my mind at the point of looking again at the milestone payments and also the loan support that the Scottish Government gave direct to FMEL as well. But the original milestone payments was an arrangement between CMAL and FMEL. Of course, CMAL will tell you it's standard what they did, and FMEL will tell you that it caused some of the problems. And then the REC Committee and the Auditor General may have other views on whether that caused problems or not.
Just quoting Mr. McCall, he said that you had advised him privately that the CMAL board would resign if you interfered in the board's proceedings. Do you recall that conversation?
No, I don't recall that kind of detail, but what I would have expressed to Mr. McCall at the time, and I think the evidence fairly shows this now, that there had been a breakdown in relationships. Ministers couldn't interfere. And there's some reference, and Convener, I've seen you refer to this as well, of a legal position. And what you now subsequently know, thanks to the evidence that's come out and the papers released, that there was indeed dispute over both parties' positions, and both had a different legal position. So what I would have expressed, and you will appreciate how, having seen all the evidence and counter-evidence you've had so far, how difficult this was to manage and to try and ensure that we kept doing the right thing. So I would have expressed the frustration with the issue, the fact that the vessels were late and that, you know, that we were concerned by that. I would have expressed the frustration of CMAL, but equally I gave FMEL a fair hearing because they had a case to make as well, which you've heard. This was a total breakdown in relationships, and I would have expressed that in the meeting. And, you know, if there was a reason we couldn't have proceeded with expert determination or anything else that had a legal impasse, then it had a legal impasse, and possibly that's what Jim McCall was referring to.
But let me press you on the particular statement that Mr. McCall made, which is that you said the CMAL board would resign, which is fairly dramatic.
Yeah, I think it's fair to say, as you've now seen from the evidence, as it went on, the there was conflict between CMAL and FMEL, and I was expressing that, the relationship breakdown, but there was no letter, you know, I've seen an evidence, you know, and when a hearing about that, you know, I've checked, there was no letter about resignation from the CMAL board. So, you know, I don't remember saying that, but I do remember expressing the concern about all the issues, about how dissatisfied CMAL was. FMEL was obviously clearly frustrated as well, and they were having that dispute. And I was trying to navigate a way through this in the interests of taxpayers, interests, island communities, the workforce at the yard, and to try and find a resolution. So I was probably expressing my exasperation at the issue, which I think, having seen the evidence now, you would well understand.
You've said that you found some government arrangements to be a barrier to resolving the dispute. Could you maybe give us a little more information on that?
Yes, specifically transport governance arrangements, particularly at the time, because when I was Transport Minister, I just felt that having, you know, CMAL as an agency, the contractual arrangements as they were, Transport Scotland, and then when problems emerged, of course I was being advised by a multitude of people at that point for good reason, and I just felt that it's quite a cluttered landscape in transport governance at that point. But of course, when dealing with the daily issues as Transport Minister, you also don't necessarily want to embark on structural reform when you were dealing then with the issues that we were dealing with. But I have had a view for some time that the transport governance arrangements We're far from perfect. Now, the REC Committee has made the same conclusion in their inquiry.
Looking at the loan support for FMEL, and in particular, I would ask, why did you approve the drawdown of £30 million, which was conditional on the vessel's progress? Because the progress wasn't there. I mean, there's clear evidence that the vessels were in delay already. So given that the funding was linked to progress, what was the justification?
So the government has a wider... It's a fair question, Mr Beattie, but the government has a wider responsibility. Of course we had a responsibility to try and complete the contracts, but our wider responsibility was also around the yard's future, the workforce, and for that reason the government made other interventions. And in the conditions, and I'm not entirely sure how much I can speak about the conditions without encroaching into commercial confidentiality. Some of it, I think, is in the public domain. But there were conditions attached to the funding, and the funding was primarily to help diversify the business, try and secure further work, but of course help with the immediate cash flow issues, i.e. workers needed to be paid, convener. Workers needed to be paid. I wasn't going to have a situation where the staff potentially were going to be made redundant, get sent home, not get paid, and all the consequences that that could have had. Therefore, the wider economic and community interests that we would have had in mind as a government at the time came into that consideration in the loan payment. So there were conditions, and as part of that, of course, we appointed an expert to give assurance around progress on the vessels. Now, it then turns out, in addition to all the other advice I was telling you about earlier, that advice was challenged and was then contradicted by others. Such was the nature of the dispute. But the issue around the loans was a very specific intervention with the government's wider interests in mind, and that was more than just the contract. Of course we were trying to ensure that the contract was progressed and the vessels were complete and they got on with that work and suppliers would be paid and the work would continue, but I was not going to have the workforce sacrificed as part of this process.
So although there was fairly solid information that the vessels were in delay and there was conditions around the payment of the £30 million that there had to be progress on the vessels, you took a public interest view?
Yes.
Rather than simply a literal view of the contract?
Yeah, wider. I'd say public interest, yes, of course, but wider interest, because, you know, if there was an industrial difficulty somewhere, and I know the convener is very fond, and quite rightly so, of industrial interventions, you would expect the government to have got involved whether we had this contract or not, would you not? If jobs were at risk, if there was the viability of Scottish shipbuilding, commercial shipbuilding and the Clyde was at risk, you'd expect us to get involved. Now, there's the matters that we've covered on the contract, but the loans was part of helping the business diversify, it get on with progress on the vessels. That's why we had appointed an independent expert to try and reassure us, because we were getting different messages between CMAL, FMAL, as to the nature of progress and the nature of difficulties. So we brought in another independent expert, got another view, but we did try and use that information to help us with the drawdown of loan funding. But I've been very clear on what the purpose of the loan funding was, and the actual effect of it was to ensure, the effect was to ensure that the business clearly could continue. And I have got involved in other industrial interventions, such as Michelin, of course, in Dundee, where the company decided to withdraw, and I got involved with interventions there to ensure that Dundee had a future and Michelin had a future. So it's not uncommon for the government to get involved where there was a risk to business or to communities or expertise. And I think if the yard had ever closed and the workforce were sent home, I don't think it would ever have recovered from that.
I guess one of the most important things, the other side of the coin really, is how they spent the money. And in your submission, you have a fairly short response, yes, and information was forthcoming. What was that information and how was it supplied to you?
At that point in the process, we were being advised, as well as the independent advisor, Transport Scotland, CMAL, of course, were feeding information through their sponsor agency. But PwC were engaged in the process as well. So they were looking at the conditions and cash flow and other matters. And I assume you'll come to the question, what was the money spent on?
Exactly.
Yeah. Wages and supplies. That was my understanding. Clear as that. You put in these loans, the business can diversify. We can continue with work. We'll make progress in the vessels. The yard will have a future. And we'll continue to make progress. But the money, of course, was actually spent in line with that, but on wages to keep people working on the vessels and supplies so that contractors could be paid, because, of course, there's jobs involved in that as well. And, of course, if these vessels were successfully completed, then the yard would have a future in an ongoing programme of work. And they were also bidding for other work at the same time, another reason to keep the yard going in what was quite a stressful and distressed time.
So you received the information on this from several different sources, which must have been pulled together someplace. Is there a document that covers that?
So what I recall is convening meetings. I convened meetings with all officials involved. So we would have been advised by Transport Scotland, other relevant officials, whether that's from procurement or finance, and the advisers from PwC. So yes, I had briefings with officials. And as I've said earlier, I can't go through my entire diary for, so this is 2015 through to 2020, 7 years, but there were meetings, there were updates, ministers were briefed, and I was satisfied with the lack of progress, but satisfied that the information was forthcoming that you asked me about at the time.
Camille, do you want me to carry on?
If you could briefly touch on the question of nationalisation, Colin, then I'll bring Graeme Simpson in after that.
Right, let me touch on nationalisation. I mean, one of the key things here is that the decision was taken to nationalise the company, but there seems to have not been a full due diligence carried out, as would normally have been the case. Can you maybe comment on that, why that was the case?
Well, I would disagree with the premise of the question. As I've said, there were numerous meetings with numerous officials, advisers from PwC, and there had reached a point, clearly, where all other opportunities and options had been exhausted. And I think much of this information has actually been released in December 2019, is on the government's information release around the events leading to nationalisation. We whittled down something like 27 options to about three. And in the end, there came a crisis point, a critical point, where it looked like FML was going to go into administration, and therefore the government had to act if we wanted to safeguard the workforce and ensure that the yard had a future. So as much due diligence it could be carried out, was carried out at the time. Clearly, we wouldn't have had access to absolutely everything, but we had enough information, and I certainly had enough information to judge that nationalisation was the right thing to do for many, many reasons. But foremost, the three objectives were complete the vessels, safeguard the jobs, and give the yard a future. And in the end, that appeared to be, and I still believe to be the case, the right intervention at the time. And that's why we took that decision. So there was, I think even the Auditor General refers to this in his report. There's no lack of documentation or information around this issue in terms of the decision to proceed with nationalisation, certainly consider the options.
Now, my memory is that the accountable officer, and I can't remember his name, said that only a partial due diligence could be carried out, partly due to, I think it was time that was quoted, and availability of information.
So the point I'd make there is we carried out, and I think I said this in my answer to your question, Mr. Beattie, that we carried out as much due diligence as was possible at the time. FML wouldn't have been under an obligation to give the Scottish Government and our agencies absolutely everything that we might choose to have. And, of course, with conflicting reports on the state of the vessels and how long it would take to complete them, it would have been hard to come up with an accurate assessment of progress at the yard and where the vessels were without having direct control in the end because of the conflicting nature of information that was forthcoming to government. And maybe that's what's meant by due diligence, but there was no lack of due diligence, there was no lack of inquiring into our options, and no lack of effort in trying to find the right thing to do. And I tell you exactly what the consequences would have been if we hadn't nationalised in the fashion that we did that day. It would have gone into administration, workers would have been sent home, and I believe that would have severely impacted the yard's ability in the future to recover, because obviously workers would have to find new jobs, now they would lose the expertise, so on and so forth. So that continuity in a crisis, I felt, was necessary and absolutely the right thing to do.
Now, given the decision was taken without a full understanding of the costs and challenges within the company, and in the light of subsequent issues, given its history, do you still think it was the right thing to do?
Nationalisation?
Yeah.
Yes. Because it has allowed us to continue on the completion of the vessels, taking much longer than anyone would like, of course, and costing more than anyone would have liked, of course. But we were determined to complete the vessels, and clearly there was advice if we had started again, it would take longer. So complete the vessels, safeguard the workforce, because you know the workforce are blameless in this. And I said earlier, I didn't want the workforce to be sacrificed in this. So I tried to ensure that there was continuity from one day to the next in the arrangements to continue with the efforts at the yard to complete the vessels, safeguard that workforce and give the yard a future. And incidentally, Mr. Beattie, I believe that the yard does actually have a promising future, and I wish them well in continuing. But if the decision to nationalise hadn't been taken, I fear for the consequences of the yard, notwithstanding the regrettability of failure to complete these vessels on time and on budget. But I can assure you I exhausted every option throughout to try and complete the vessels, support the workforce and give the yard a future through every intervention that I could.
I'll leave it at that, can
you? Thank you. In the remaining minutes that we've got, I want to bring in Craig Hoy briefly, and then I'll ask Graeme Simpson if he's got a question to put to you, Mr. Mackay. Craig Hoy.
Convener, just in relation to nationalisation, and you say all options were exhausted, I just wanted to challenge that, because Jim McCall said that he put to you a QC's report that would have shown that a financial restructuring would have meant that FML, he, and the government would have split any future risk, potentially saving the taxpayer £100 million. He says he gave you that QC's report and that you ignored it or dismissed it without taking legal advice. Is that correct?
That is correct, Mr. Hoy, that he did put that proposition to me and to the Scottish Government. The reason that I couldn't take that proposition forward, because of course I explored it. There was never anything that I didn't explore in hearing sympathetically from anyone involved in this issue, but it could not proceed, frankly, that proposition, because we didn't have a legal basis to proceed. Now, some of this is already in the public domain, that Mr. McCall had one legal opinion, the Scottish Government would have had a different legal opinion. And CMAL, of course, as they have advised you, regularly take legal advice as well. So I just want to state for the record, I was advised by officials that that proposition could not be taken forward because it would have breached the advice that we had been given.
Okay, and did you seek an independent QC's legal advice on that, or did you just take the advice of officials?
No, legal opinion was sought to form that advice.
Are you certain of that?
Am I certain that we took, that legal advice was taken to inform that opinion?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, thanks. Graeme Simpson. Graeme, do you want to put your questions?
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Mackay.
Morning.
Good to see you.
And Jim.
Can I just ask you about this? Go back to the preferred bidder decision. Have I picked you up right that you weren't involved in that at all?
The submission on preferred bidder?
Yes.
Yes, that submission went to Keith Brown, yes.
Right. So it was his decision and his decision alone. Was anyone else involved?
Well, I wasn't involved, which is the question you're putting to me. I suppose you'd have to ask others who else was involved in that. But I think Keith Brown took that decision. I, as you know, was on annual leave. I can only speak to the decisions that I've taken, and then I can't speak for what other people might know or might not know. You can look at the copy list, who has been copied into submissions.
I accept you had a holiday, but there must have been discussions before you went on holiday about that issue. Were you not involved in any discussions at all?
I would have been involved, of course, on state of progress, but not an indication of this is what's about to happen. What I would have been indicated to me as a submission is about to come. Now, the minister's not there, the cabinet secretary can take a decision, and that's what happened. I wasn't there, so the cabinet secretary took a decision at that stage on preferred bidder status.
Okay, so that's nothing to do with you, but what was to do with you was the ultimate decision to award the contract. And can I just be clear that you did know about the concerns of CMAL when you took that decision?
Yes, as I've said this morning, I was given a comprehensive briefing on the 8th of October about the concerns, but also the resolutions to that. And fundamentally, what I was being asked to do was authorisation to proceed. Not to revisit, not to refuse, you know, not to go back to the start. I was being asked to authorise to proceed, and that's what I did, based on all the information I had before me.
Convener, I've got just one other area I want to explore, and this is when things started to go wrong. You've been asked about this already. You had a meeting with Jim McCall in the Parliament in June 2018, and this is when CMAL and FMAL were, at loggerheads. Jim McCall asked you to intervene, he says, and instructs CMAL to take part in the expert determination process, let's call that mediation. And according to him, you said you couldn't intervene. So is his recollection correct?
So I think I tried to answer this to Mr. Beattie. I think that was asked again me about this, that I expressed concern about the whole issue, but it wouldn't be true to say that I didn't make efforts to intervene. I think I've quite comprehensively outlined the many efforts I made to intervene, but specifically on mediation through Transport Scotland, because remember, Transport Scotland is the sponsored body that engages with CMAL. I did encourage mediation. I did encourage expert determination. I did encourage all sorts of interventions, including a review of was the procurement carried out properly, you know, in-house by our procurement officials. So I did exhaust every option possible.
That's not what I'm asking. I'm asking you about that specific meeting where he says you told him, I cannot tell CMAL to get involved in mediation.
I encouraged CMAL to get involved through Transport Scotland, a discussion with them and trying to find a resolution. So much so CMAL tells you that in the evidence. They said in their evidence sessions that they did feel that ministers wanted mediation, but they couldn't do it. And then they outlined the reasons they couldn't do mediation, because they felt, in their words, there was no legal basis to take that forward. So in different stages, in mediation, couldn't agree the terms of reference, when that could have been agreed, couldn't get a mediator. But fundamentally, the reason expert determination or mediation couldn't have proceeded, from memory, was the advice was it couldn't lead to the conclusion which FML fundamentally wanted, which was more money for a fixed price contract. And CMAL's view is that cannot be done and should not be done, and no mediation will sort that. That is, you know, in short, why it was felt that mediation couldn't proceed, in the words of CMAL, as advised to me.
Finally from me, Convener, would you agree with me that this has been a shambles from start to finish?
So I think there's two sides to this coin. The first is that it is very regrettable that the vessels are not yet complete. I look forward to them being complete, of course. Everyone does, particularly island communities. And then I look forward to Ferguson's Port Glasgow having a future. And so whilst, of course, I've said at the outset, I'll take my share of responsibility, and I think it's regrettable, but equally, every action I took had in my mind Scottish shipbuilding, island communities, the workforce. And let's not forget, there was a cross-party campaign to save Ferguson's, which, of course, happened in 2014. So there's political support for Ferguson's, I think, across the board. So whilst there's a lot of support course we want contracts to be delivered with value for money. So it is regrettable what has gone wrong. And of course, lessons need to be learned about that. And that's why this committee's work is so important. The previous committee's work is so important. The Auditor General work is so important. But in saying I take my share of responsibility, I hope the committee appreciates my efforts also to do the right thing by the yard, by the workforce, and by Scottish shipbuilding so that it has a future. And I do believe if it wasn't for the actions that had been taken by me and others at the time, it wouldn't be here today.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, look, thank you. I've got one very quick, probably yes or no question for you, Mr. Mackay, which is you mentioned in the passing there about whether it was a fixed price contract or not. Is it your belief that it was a fixed price contract that you approved?
Yes.
It is. Thank you. We've heard a lot of conflicting evidence over the course of the last few months, both in writing and orally, and it's our duty as a committee to try to get to the bottom of that and, I suppose, exercise a test of reasonableness in what we believe. So can I thank you for your evidence this morning, which I think has illuminated some of that. In some areas, it's perhaps created more areas where there appears to be conflicting evidence, but we appreciate your willingness to appear before us and your frankness. And if, of course, there are other issues on reflection that you want to bring to our attention, then please don't hesitate to do that. And again, thank you for your time this morning. And I'm now going to call the public part of this morning's committee to a close. Thank you.